Hey, Doc, we better back up. We don't have enough road to get up to 88.
Roads? Where we're going, we don't need roads. It's the Lion Gate, and you can see, you can see like, and you can see why there's two lions, each side of. Another thing, the name, the English, the Christian name for it is Saint Stephen Gate. Because Stephen, yeah, Stephen went out. The Muslim name is Saint Mary Gate.
Maria.
Because the Muslims believe in the Holy Family, and they actually worship the tomb of Mary. Yeah. They worship the tomb of Mary. Then in that case, you can understand why it's so important. Then let's go into the city. And as you can see, the people are coming to pray, and it's like a market time. The wall, yes. There's no reason to die today. The walls are from the 16th century, then the doors are from the 16th century too. Now, look to your left side. You can see the Muslims entering into the Temple Mount. Be careful! Yeah, I know. Then you can see the Muslims are going in to pray. But we are going to... Thank you.
My, what a peculiar place to have a party. You know, Dino, we really shouldn't be doing this. After all, we haven't been invited, and curiosity often leads to trouble.
I imagine that right now you're feeling a bit like Alice, tumbling down the rabbit hole.
Tesla's secret experiment. X-rays, microwaves, radiation therapy, radar, every harmful beam you can imagine was created by Trump's paternal uncle. He was involved in all of them. All this before confiscating the work of Nikola Tesla on the 33rd floor of the New York City Hotel.
Hello, SGD, Sacred Geometry Decoded. I'm just going to follow on with this series in regards to the importance of the number 33 across time, across cultures, across the world. This focus of this one will be on churches and cathedrals. So, number 33. Earlier I did an episode just on religion, so just some of the examples of Christianity, but also connections to Masonic traditions as well. So for instance, Jacob's ladder. Jacob mentioned 33 times before having this dream, and like the ladder, stairway to heaven. It's interesting, Genesis 33:1. But okay, King David, 40-year reign, but 33 in Jerusalem. Jesus, 40 days in the wilderness, but he was 33 when he died. Leviticus 12:3, 33 days, also 66 days in regards to after childbirth and whether women can enter the temple. But Anglican rosary, and this will be important, the Anglican rosary, 33 beads. So now we go back to Newtown here in Sydney, St. Stephen's Anglican Church, by this very important, very important architect, Edmund Blackett, not just for Australia, but it was also at the time he was considered something of a world expert on Gothic architecture. And this is just one of the churches he built. And his original grave site was here at St. Stephen's in Newtown, along with his wife. So that's St. Stephen's Anglican in Newtown. His body was moved to St. Andrew's Anglican Cathedral, the major cathedral here in Sydney, and there's a plaque there as well. Now, for instance, it's just a section from one of the booklets at the church, St. Andrew's Anglican Cathedral. What it lacks in size, a clever treatment of the interior, entirely the work of Edmund Blackett, the brilliant architect who contributed many fine churches and buildings to Australia, including the Great Hall, Main Quadrangle at Sydney University, many other buildings as well. Blackett was a designer of some 100 churches and a world authority on Gothic architecture. His memorial plaque, so St. Andrew's are some of the finest examples of 19th century Gothic revival style. It was not the biggest church, but the beauty of it is a very, very beautiful cathedral. It's here in Sydney. We had some excellent architects and the stonemasons here at the time. Brilliant stuff here in Australia. But the tower height, 130 feet, but the height of a cathedral itself, 97 feet. So 130 minus 97 is 33 feet. It's embedded in there as well. But back to St. Stephen's Anglican Church, Newtown, by Edmund Blackett. So the height of the spire, 132 feet, or two Gunter's chain of 66 feet, or four, sometimes called Rathbone chain, of 33 feet. So it's a nice division of 33. However, the length of the church is 110 feet long. That's 330 hands. But that's not the only reference, because inside the clerestory itself is 33 feet high. Now, St. Peter and Paul's old Catholic cathedral in Goulburn, here in Australia as well. Entering from Bourke Street, the visitor beholds an unbroken space of 141 by 33 feet wide. while the transept, so the long axis, so just like cathedrals are designed like a cross, so the long axis to transepts is basically the short piece going across, and they're 33 feet wide and 30 feet high, but 33 feet again in this Catholic cathedral. St. Patrick's Catholic Cathedral in Manhattan, the spires are 330 feet high, which brings us to Chartres Cathedral, which is one of the holy of holies of architecture. And it was at a time when Chartres and these other great early Gothic cathedrals suddenly popped up, this architecture, because before you had Romanesque, and so you had very thick walls with very little windows, very little light. It was a very dark space. What happened? Essentially, it's when the Templars, or you could say in the Knights of St. John, the Hospitallers returned from the Holy Land. There was an explosion of knowledge. The Corpus Hermeticum was reintroduced to Europe, and we saw an explosion of architecture. So, for instance, this is 377 feet high in total, 365 feet to Sun Tower, as it's called. So you have the Tower of the Moon, the Tower of the Sun. Now, the stonework is 365 feet, as in 365 days per year, but the total height is 377. But that's done some videos previously on this, but keep in mind, 365 feet, the Tower of the Sun at Chartres. But even the buildings themselves, why are they have, you know, essentially, you know, in regards to their height, to their width, it's very thin walls. The walls themselves is largely glass. You have this massive space. This is extreme architecture, astounding architecture. And so other great cathedrals such as Chartres were actually the first buildings higher than the Great Pyramid. But the thing is, these were hollow. And so this architecture doesn't get the recognition that it believe, because this is hollow. You know, now piling up and building some shafts, Great Pyramid, awesome architecture. The volume is massive, but there is no ancient architecture that rivals the cathedrals, except for maybe the Pantheon, or the Blue Mosque and Sophia in Istanbul, in that they're hollow. And I would defy anyone who wants to say that these are, because the blocks aren't as big, or, well, you pile up a hollow pyramid, best of luck to you. You make something like this with paper thin walls, full of windows, the glass itself, it's still a mystery how some of these were to be done. Yet even computer modeling can't explain how these buildings hold themselves up. And now, they might not be the most seismic areas, but over time, it's still over centuries and centuries, you have a lot of, you know, the earth is dynamic, and these things are just effing fantastic, and they're just not included because I don't know why, but this architecture rivals anything, really, not in volume, but in skill, to build a hollow, essentially paper thin walls, and support this height, and the beauty of it. Amazing stuff, amazing. But the nave is 121 feet high. One of another of these amazing cathedrals from this just Corpus Hermeticum is Bourges and Borgia. Part of my pronunciation, but there we see the nave again, and these the domes and the flying buttresses, just brilliant stuff. And that's 121 feet high, the nave. Which brings us to St. Paul's Cathedral by Christopher Wren, a very famous figure, very important figure. Now the total, so how high is it? It's 365 feet. Chartres Cathedral to the top of the stonework, 365 feet. 377 if you include the entirety of it. But again, a reference, multiple references, but St. Paul's Cathedral, well, there are 528 steps to the top, which is a nice little tip of a hat to this hermetic knowledge architect. But so the length of it, including the front steps, is 555 feet or 6,660 inches. The nave width is 121 feet. And to understand why that is important, we need to go back to, let's begin with Mohenjo-Daro. So one of the standardized street widths in there is 33 feet. The Mohenjo-Daro ruler is 1.1 modern feet, so therefore 30 Mohenjo-Daro feet is 33 feet. However, the Mohenjo-Daro foot of 1.1 feet, or 13.2 inches, is the same as what was later used, the Royal Babylonian foot, or the Saxon, or Drusian, or North German foot. This ancient measure actually drew on. Now, I did a series on recently on pendulums and how all these different units actually, through the meter, through the second, all these apparently different separate units, such as this Mohenjo-Daro, Saxon, Royal Babylonian, Druze, will connect to the canonical foot and to the Royal Egyptian cubit and others. But so this is actually the Saxon foot. So when we look at Chartres Cathedral now, or others of the great cathedrals, especially in France, the English foot, 121 foot, what were they building with the English foot? No, they were building with the Saxon or the North German or the Mohenjo-Daro foot, or the English. Well, it's actually hard to say because they're all the same, and they're actually through the pendulum, the second, the cubit, and the meter all come back and reinforce one another in harmonic ways. Not just everything will convert to something if you just with a simple conversion, but they convert back to whole numbers and beautiful whole numbers. But so 121 feet, that's 330 Saxon hands, 330 Saxon hands, which again is linked to the Royal Babylonian or the Mohenjo-Daro and these other units. So 330, 333 in different units, different. It's always repeated. Now also at Chartres Cathedral, which portal is this? The west. And what we have is, well, Aristotle, Pythagoras, Ptolemy, Euclid's Elements, famous geometry. So you have famous astronomers, mathematicians, Greek ones here on this Chartres Cathedral. But we also have dialectic, rhetoric, geometry, math or arithmetic, astronomy, and grammar and music. And what are they? They are grammar, dialectic, rhetoric, music, astronomy, arithmetic, geometry, and astronomy. These are the seven liberal arts. Now, the seven liberal arts are usually said to have emerged around about this time, because these type of cathedrals were not just temples. They were treasury buildings, university buildings, administrative centers. They were much more than just a church. And we see here, so they were teaching the seven liberal arts here. There are many people who would just show that the seven liberal arts have their origins at least in ancient Greece, which would then say, well, where did the Greeks and Romans, they learnt from Heliopolis and the Egyptians and the Chaldeans. So you could, not stretching the bow too long to say that the seven liberal arts emerged much older, but at least solid, in a solid, undeniable, factual sense, seven liberal arts, Chartres Cathedral, and this period. And why is that important? Because look at a Mason tracing book. Now, Masons even say that they emerge from these cathedral builders. Could be a lot to be said about that. We see like a tracing board. We see the three, the five, and the seven steps. Now we have, the five orders of architecture, composite, Corinthian, Ionic, Doric, Tuscan, which relate to one of the five senses. But we have the top seven steps, and there's more to this than just this, but the seven steps: astronomy, music, geometry, arithmetic, logic, rhetoric, and grammar, the seven liberal arts. And is a stairway up to what do we have again? Astronomy, music, that's geometry, just arithmetic, logic, rhetoric, grammar. We see the five Roman orders of architecture, and we have wisdom, strength, and beauty as well, which are the first three steps. Now, these would also connect to the three Greek orders of architecture, which are Corinthian, Ionic, and Doric. We also connect to measure scales. But just as an example, so this inside Chartres and these other cathedrals, you'll see the compass and the square and the masons at work. And stone, you know, masons began as stone masons, tilers, also brick masons, the skills, you know, Masonic as in masonry skills as well. Is the even the Masons themselves say they will even claim that it goes back further to Greek and Roman, because it's just full of stonework and back to Egypt, you know, where these stone, the magic of the stone workers and the special skills involved, the science of doing Because it wasn't just hammer and chisel, they were using different methods. So, but anyway, that's something else. So the connections between the seven liberal arts, geometry, music, arithmetic, and especially the quadrivium, astronomy, geometry, music, and arithmetic. And we see it used by architects still embedded in biblical traditions, but also going through to so this is Australia, but we, again, going back to the ancient Gothic cathedrals as well, and it's always in that, or it is essential. It is an essential part of this type of architecture, but we can find again in the ancient world, in ancient from the UK way right over to ancient India. It's there, it's repeated, and it's a constant, and it's not just one, it's not just about 33, it's about having multiple levels, such as 365, 528, and or 555 being 6,660 inches. And it's a long story. Anyway, cheerio, have a good one.
So how does Trump fit into all this? Well, Trump's uncle was brought in when Tesla died, okay, in this hotel. So Trump's uncle was at MIT for decades. Trump was involved in radar research for the Allies in the Second World War. And in 1943, the FBI had enough faith in his technical ability and his discretion to call him in when Nikola Tesla died in his room at the New Yorker Hotel in Manhattan, raising the question of whether enemy agents might have had a chance to learn some of his secrets before the body was found. One fear was that Tesla was working on a death ray. I mean, who knows what this thing could have been, right? This could have been a giant laser. Maybe they were creating a giant laser that shot up and was trying to break the firmament. I mean, who knows? All this stuff is connected. The Hoover Dam's connected to the Twin Towers, connected to the New Yorker Hotel, connected to the One World Freedom Tower. These Masons build these things, okay? They build them. And it's all part of a plan that transcends generations. It transcends people's ages, which points to a higher intelligence. And I got news for you. It ain't God. It ain't God, okay? These people are transcending their own lifespans in these projects and passing on the information generation to generation. It's unbelievable sometimes when you try to wrap your brain around what's really going on here. I mean, I've got these numbers up and I can't even believe it myself. 33,000 square feet of meeting space. He knew. I mean, he would know. He knows what 33 means. He wasn't dumb. Would they really have, would he have really let them put him on the 33rd floor without knowing about what 33 means? I mean, 33 transcends into the scientific world as well. There's a lot of things that 33 relates to, not just in the spiritual realm, but the scientific realm as well. And he must have been onto it. The fact that he was, it was 1933, he was 77. I mean, he must have put all this together, okay? He wasn't a stupid man, which suggests that he was part of it. But again, I don't know. It's a mirror. It's a 33 mirror, which is the same as this generator, the steam generator. This is also a 3 mirrored. Look at that. 33 in the floor plan of this building, the New Yorker Hotel. Now remember, that generator that you're looking at on your screen right now is almost the same steam generator that's down in the basement of this building. So it's definitely intentional in the floor plan of the building.
Delivery.
Mysterious coin. Update arrives on front doorstep.
life? Oh, you're a box. Very handsome. Commanding. Where did you come from? Now, if my measurements are correct,
I am Conor MacLeod of the Clan MacLeod. I was born in 1518 in the village of Glenfinnan on the shores of Loch Shiel, and I am immortal.
Happy Halloween, ladies.
The Trump Highlander Matrix Revealed. This amazing story begins in the 1986 film Highlander, starring Christopher Lambert. Lambert plays the Highlander Conor MacLeod, the same clan surname of Trump's mother. Lambert and I share the same birthday, the 88th day of the year, March 29th, as does the wrestler pictured in the opening scenes. The film is about time travel, or at least the next best thing, extended life that transcends generations.
From the dawn of time we came, moving silently down through the centuries.
Bring victory to the Clan MacLeod!
MacLeod!
Victory to MacLeod!
Living many secret lives, struggling to reach the time of the gathering.
When only a few of us are left, we will feel an irresistible pull towards a faraway land
to fight for the prize.
And the few who remain will battle to the last. No one has ever known we were among you.
Here we are, born to be kings.
It was then I realized that the pool was the portal.
The connections between the TV series Outlander and the film Highlander are also very present. Both plots center around timeless beings. A Trump whose mother was born 14 miles away from and 77 degrees from these time-traveling stones is at the center of this story. What is it about these stones? Does time travel really represent the immovable bloodlines that rule the world? Or is there more to this? The star of Outlander, the TV series, Claire Frazier, was born with 88 days remaining in the year on October 4th. This is the mirror birthday of the Highlander main character and the Freebirds wrestler we just talked about. And now you are finally beginning to understand that the number 88 represents time travel.
There can be only one!
Here in more of the opening scenes, we see a flag with the red flames on a blue mountain that are specific to the coat of arms of the ancient MacLeods of the Isle of Lewis. Now, there were many MacLeod clans in the Upper Highlands of Scotland, but only one with this specific coat of arms on the Isle of Lewis, the very small island where the time travel stones exist and Trump's mother was born 14 miles away. In other words, Trump's mother's ancient family coat of arms matches the one seen in Highlander, the film. So, in the film, he's banished from Scotland to New York. When he fails to die from a fatal wound, they think it's a kind of sorcery or witchcraft. He doesn't die. He transcends time. They banish him. They accuse him of being a witch. And we know that Trump's mother also immigrated from the Scottish Highlands to New York.
You're banning here today. We'll banish him.
No!
MacLeod!
He takes on the identity of an art dealer and lives on Hudson Street, Trump has apartments on Hudson Street.
You asked. I spent all night going through the old deeds to Nash's house on Hudson Street.
Here you see the 77 trucks. Remember, his mother was born 77 degrees from the time travel circle of the stones. And of course, we know all of the 77 synchronicities that are specific to Trump, as well as the 88 synchronicities. Now, the final battle in Highlander, the film, takes place at the famous Silver Cup Studios in Queens, New York, the very same city that Trump was born in. Now, this is where things get creepy, because Trump Tower was a few years old during the scene, and you can see it in the night skyline next to the Queensboro Bridge. In this final scene, as Highlander is rescuing the girl at the famed Silver Cup Studio sign, this is when it all comes together. In fact, Queen even performed the soundtrack for Highlander.
Whatever you say, Jack, you're the master race.
You cannot die, MacLeod. Accepted.
Brandy. Bottled in 1783. Was a very good year. Mozart wrote his great mass. The Montgolfier brothers went up in their first balloon. England recognized the independence of the United States.
Is that right?
Yes.
And here, to confirm our beliefs and findings, Tim Newark, an author, meets Donald Trump in Trump Tower, New York. They share Highland roots. Trump says of Tim's Highlander, "Great book. This is where I got my fighting spirit." And now you know the truth about the strange matrix that we live in. There is only one way out of this endless time loop, and that is Jesus Christ. Take care and be safe, you guys. Hey guys, enter the stars. Gemini, May 21st through June 21st. The twins. I want you to remember this date, May 21st to June 21st. The film Evil Twin released May 23rd in Gemini. This is the cover of Van Halen. A band with two brothers, not twins, but two brothers, Eddie and Alex Van Halen. And on their cover, we see the evil twin brother. We have celebrity twins, Alanis Morissette, born in Gemini on June 1st. We have Mary-Kate and Ashley, the twins, born in Gemini on June 13th.
In the starlit nights I saw you, so cruelly you kissed me. Your lips a magic world, your sky all hung with jewels. The killing moon will come too soon. Fate up against your will, through the thick and thin, he will wait until.
Sometimes when this place gets kind of empty,
28 days,
sound of the breath fades with the
6 hours, 42 minutes,
I think about
12 seconds,
the loveless fascination under the Milky Way tonight
is when the world will end.
Curtain down Memphis, lower the curtain down, all right. I got no time for private consultation under the Milky Way tonight. Wish I knew what you.
Yeah, the one time Trump lost, he said it was rigged. The few weeks
first,
ago,
first, there's lost. Two Trumps.
Okay.
The one in the red tie is the real one. The one in the blue tie is not. The one you saw last night after the victory was the blue tie. Now, if you would punch up Dr. Carson, Ben Carson, when Trump called him a pedophile, and the next day he joined Trump. And the guy asked him, see, every now and then you slip and say something. He said, why'd you do that? He said, there's two Trumps. I was with the good one. You see it there. Just punch up when somebody interviewed him, he said, there's two Donald Trumps. That's easy to pull up.
Who is that guy? I know him. Is he the community announcer?
He's the president of America.
He has a clone.
He's an absolute idiot.
Yeah, I never liked him either. Do a lot of people see this?
The news, a lot.
Then if we can get on there together, people will see us and they'll know the truth.
Oh.
Sometimes I think Donald Trump is really a set of twins. I do. There's Donald Trump and Ronald Trump. And they're masquerading as the same person, but sometimes they just can't get their story straight.
Gentlemen, Oreo has rejected my bid to buy the DSRL, so we lick race for it right here with Double Stuff Gold.
Mr. Trump, my brother and I are the defending champions. And let's be honest, you don't even have a partner.
Oh, I've got a partner.
No, you don't.
Yes, I do.
No, you don't.
Yes, I do.
Me.
No way. It's
Double Trump. And we're gonna be huge.
Let's get this party started.
I've set up the simulation so that we, the Donalds, can practice against the Mannings before the big race.
Great idea.
Terrific.
You just lost to a piece of cardboard. Boys, welcome to the Trump Dome.
This is just your office.
Cool it, Johnny Touchdown.
Ready! Gentlemen, you're about to lose to the smartest.
Sit. Most classy.
Lick. Highest quality.
Handsomest DSRL champions ever. In fact, soon the Trump Organization will acquire the Manning name and turn it into a luxury.
Done. Done. Winner! Taste it, Trump.
How's that feel, Donnie?
You're fired.
You're fired.
Nice suit.
You're a dashing man.
I know it. Yes! Where are my golden double stuffed cookies?
Right where they belong.
That's terrific.
It is.
I really like it.
I do too.
Check it out. It's the new DSRL theme song. It's the league of the future now. It's got two Trumps. Trump, 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 Trump. Golden double stuffed Oreo. Trump.
I love it.
Welcome back. A fact is a fact is a fact. But President Trump's recent comments to Friends, as reported by the New York Times, have made us wonder, does he know about an alternative universe, his own bizarro world where the sun is the moon and a lie is the truth? That's the subject of this week's State of the Cartoon.
Comic book aficionados know Superman has his arch enemy Bizarro, who lives in a topsy-turvy world where stop means go and yes means no. And increasingly it sounds as though there's a Bizarro Trump who also lives in a world of opposites.
This reality, this wonderful place.
In the real world, in reality, we all heard President Trump say this about that hideous Access Hollywood tape.
I've said and done things I regret, and the words released today on this more than a decade-old video are one of them.
But for Bizarro Trump? Well, the New York Times reports that he's still insisting the tape might not be his voice.
Totally fake and made up. It's like a novel.
Here on planet Earth, President Trump finally admitted this.
President Barack Obama was born in the United States, period.
But in Bizarro world, we're told, the president is still questioning the authenticity of President Obama's birth certificate.
In other breaking news, the world is round, not flat.
You can see this phenomenon almost everywhere, whether it's how often the president golfs or how well he's doing in the polls.
I'm getting tremendous support. Even in your polls, I'm getting tremendous support.
In fact, what we're all watching these days, it makes a lot more sense if, as a kid, you read a lot of Superman comic books.
This is reality. You know it, they know it, I know it, and pretty much the whole world knows it.
I can't live like this anymore.
Maybe it's time to take a good hard look in the mirror. Ooh.
Hey, not bad. Oh, wait, that came with the room. Oh, hello, handsome. No, Donald, cut it out. No time for that. You gotta be honest. For once in your life, get one thing off your chest where you were at fault. I'm not 100% consistent. Whoa! A little weight just came off me. More, more. You cheat at golf? You cheat on your taxes? Oh, you cheat on your wives. Come on, go for it. Here goes. You've been acting like a narcissistic sociopath, and 64% to 67% of the people hate you! Yes!
Wow, I look fantastic. No, we look fantastic, and I mean really fantastic. All right, me, we've got a big interview with Jimmy Fallon coming up. But let's be honest, Fallon's a lightweight. No way he deserves to interview me. The only one qualified to interview me is me.
Me interviewing me, that's what I call a great idea.
Of course it's a great idea. We thought of it.
Secretary Clinton is preparing for anything and everything. In fact, it is being reported that she is actually prepping for two Trumps at the debate. An on-message, disciplined Donald Trump and a freewheeling Donald Trump.
And Donald Trump says he is two Donald Trumps. And Dr. Ben Carson agreeing and then disagreeing over whether or not we're getting the real Donald Trump.
There are two different Donald Trumps. There's the one you see on the stage, and there's the one who's very cerebral, sits there and considers things very carefully. You can have a very good conversation with him. And that's the Donald Trump that you're going to start seeing more and more of right now.
I probably do agree. I think there are two Donald Trumps. I met with the president of the Virgin Islands.
With consistently so that you're ready on day one?
I'm speaking with myself, number one.
It's been a tale of two presidents. The Trump of Twitter, who lives in a dark, deeply personal pool of feuds, and the president who exists in a universe of solid, tangible economic success. Daniel Henninger with the Wall Street Journal editorial board joins us now. He is also a Fox News contributor. Interesting piece. For those who haven't seen it, they can find it in the Wall Street Journal.
Indeed.
A tale of two presidents.
Yes, well, of course, it's Donald Trump, John, and needless to say, he wasn't going to settle for just one presidency. He has given us two in one year.
Yeah.
Here comes the mirror man.
Marker?
This film is about time.
What did I tell you? 88 miles per hour!
I do this.
Flux capacitor.
This is what makes time travel possible. The flux capacitor. This is what makes time travel possible.
Jesus Christ, Doc.
A witness the birth of Christ? Makes time travel possible.
Are you telling me that this sucker is nuclear?
Arch of Titus. And that's going to be part of our discussion. And of course, what we found is a lot more spin-off things that are going to add up to some interesting things. We're also going to cover Sol Invictus and Lucifer's Eye and his promise of apotheosis. And we're going to see that as we look at the Arch of Titus today. The reason that we're looking at the Arch of Titus is that it represents a major event in all of human history. The Arch of Titus was erected after the destruction of the Jewish temple in 70 AD and also the Washington Arch. And so we took a real close look at this thing to see what is connected to this arch. And it's fascinating because Titus himself is what we call one of the sons of Jupiter, who is the resurrected Saturn. This is a group of Roman emperors that believe they're descended from the Titans. And I just wanted to go over what his origin of his name is. His name derives from the mythical Titans, the giant gods of the Greeks and Romans. And what was really interesting about Titus, other than he's associated with the Titans, is the noun is a rare form of Titus, meaning penalty, retribution, or vengeance. So we have a Roman emperor who's a son of Jupiter, who is the resurrected Saturn. We've covered the resurrected Saturn and things like that before, but we have a man's name that is associated with the Titans, destroying the Temple of Jerusalem, which is at that time in the Old Testament time in the Jewish culture was the temple of God, where God resided. So we have a man named after the Titans, who are the mythological gods of the pre-flood that ruled in the age of Saturn, sitting here destroying the temple of God, which was the god that destroyed them with the flood. That's why this becomes really fascinating to us now. The story of erecting these arches, when you look at this thing, it starts talking about the apotheosis of Titus. And this is where we get into our interesting Genesis 3:5 connection, where you shall be as gods, the original lie in the Garden of Eden, godhood, man becoming God, the original promise of the serpent. Here it is in the Arch of Titus, because it represents, they depict the apotheosis of Titus becoming a god by his brother Domitian, who erected it after the destruction of the temple. It is a declaration by the Titans against God that you destroyed us, we are going to destroy you. What's fascinating, this happened during the era after Jesus was crucified, where this building, this temple, used to be a physical residence of God's house in the Old Testament tradition. But Christ defeating the grave, shedding his blood, resurrecting, and going to heaven and sitting at the right hand of God brought about the temple transition from a structure into the followers of Christ, who became the temples themselves. And the Holy Spirit resides in us. This absolutely just rocks my world because we're looking at the age of Saturn striking at the post-flood era of the Arch of Titus, and we're looking at the resurrection of the rebellion, the Emperor of Vengeance avenging the Titans and the destruction of the deluge. Why are we seeing these arches go up now? We are seeing these arches go up because we're trying to do a repeat of history, where the focus was destroying God and his temple and his people in the land that he said was his land. Now it's the New World Order is trying to do the same thing, but this time these arches are being erected again as another statement saying that we will destroy Christianity from the face of the earth because Christians are the residents of the Holy Spirit and their temples. So we want to go back to the age of Saturn, which is pre-flood, and they are declaring this as the Golden Age. And this is my kind of roundabout way of syncing up the importance of this. And we're going to have Chris discuss what's in this arch and also how this translates to some of these modern rituals. So Chris, go ahead and talk about what's in this arch.
When Titus conquered the Jews and destroyed the temple, he sacrificed to Jupiter at that time because these people believe that they are the descendants of Jupiter. The top of the Arch of Titus is showing Titus carrying to heaven on the wings of an eagle. We know that the eagle represents Jupiter. You can see the Twin Towers right through the arch. And this is why we started looking into all of this. And there's so many connections to this, but we can only go through some of them, which tie to the sun god. Because in Washington, the arch sits, there is the sun wheel, the sun symbol, the circle with the dot in the middle. We have a lot of movies that represent the number 8, like Star Trek 8, Fast and Furious 8, Wonder Woman with the 8-pointed star of Anu on her head. And so we have all of this symbolism all around us in children's cartoons, even going through portals. The cartoons are talking about supercomputers and being your own gods, and these things are just bombarding us in this world right now with this sun worship and putting this predictive programming in everyone's heads as they build these arches and continue to put the symbolism up.
And it's hard for me to get in here and show you guys this stuff. Spring is a very crazy time around here. But something was shown to me that just, it's just crazy to me. And it relates back to the whole Notre Dame, the Temple Mount fire that really kind of went under the radar with a lot of people. This was very significant. It was just, to me, it was just illustrating the synagogue of Satan. The Jews that say they're Jews but aren't. I mean, that's just as simple as it is. And so this all connects together. Everything connects together. You know, God is just revealing all these things in part to all of us who are humbly and sincerely seeking the truth by the word of God through Jesus Christ, in revealing to us the times we're in and the diabolical plan that is about to unfold by this synagogue of Satan. All right? There's a whole bunch of things going on there. They just unveiled a replica of the altar of Baal. They call it Palmyra. They unveiled that in Damascus, Syria, the other day, right? And at the same time, they are displaying the good old Arch of Baal, which you would enter through this to get to this to perform your sacrifice. They're both being displayed at the same time, except the arch is in Geneva, Switzerland, at the Palace of Nations. The UN, UNESCO, CERN is right down the street. But that's where this is being displayed right now. And, you know, there's so much to this, you guys. Anyway, that is going on right now. But when I saw this article right here yesterday, it's talking about this old spy, yada, yada, yada. But it led me back to the independence of Israel, which we know we have the 71st year coming up on the 14th. Very important, just to say the least. Okay, so May 14th, but I went back to Israel declaring their independence. And this just kind of blew me away what I found here. Okay, their declaration ceremony, and I'll link all this stuff. I know it's a lot, but I just got to give it to you this way. When they declared their independence on May 14th, they told the recipients to arrive at 1530 and to keep the event a secret. The event started at 1600, 4 p.m., a time chosen as to not breach the Sabbath. So at 4 p.m. on May 14th, 1948, they declared their independence. Meanwhile, in the United States of America, Harry Truman was president. Harry was a simple farm boy who was responsible for dropping giant firebombs over like 100,000 people in Japan. No big deal. He also was key in bringing in NASA and establishing that giant satanic fakery. Okay? And this is all the synagogue of Satan. All of this. This goes back thousands of years. But Truman recognized the State of Israel on May 14th, 1948, 11 minutes after it declared itself a nation. Why is that important to put in historically? Well, I'll tell you why. Because at 4 o'clock, when they declared their independence in Israel, We, in the United States, are 7 hours behind them. So 4 o'clock would be 9 o'clock. So Mr. Truman recognized Israel at 9/11 on May 14th. Now, that ain't where it ended, because you remember the other day I was showing you these weird maps, right, that I came across? How in Paris the sun sets on May 1st through all the arches, right? Well, get a load of this. Everyone knows we're talking about Harry Truman, right? He recognized Israel. And we should all be familiar with the unfinished upside-down pentagram in Washington, D.C., right? Now, I'm going to do the best I can to illustrate this to you, okay? There's the unfinished pentagram in Washington, D.C. This is Washington Circle. This is New Hampshire. And this is Pennsylvania Avenue that runs to the White House and down to the Capitol. Now, you just gotta get a load of this. On May 14th, of all days, May 14th, the sun will rise in perfect alignment to complete the unfinished pentagram. That's crazy. And I hope you can see it, because I have to keep this map centered in order to show you the alignment of the sunrise. But this is the unfinished piece of the pentagram right there. And it completes itself on May 14th, the same day Harry S. Truman recognized Israel at 9/11. So, you know what I mean? What does it mean? Not really sure, but it means something. These things are all very ritualistic. They worship the sun. That you'd understand. They worship themselves, essentially. They believe that they have within them the means to attain from the tree of life and live forever without having to deal with God, without needing a savior, without having to be atoned for the filth of the flesh. And they are of their father, the devil. That's who runs Israel right now, people. That's just the way it is. And not just Israel, but Washington, D.C., Paris, France, New York, New York. This is the New World Order, and the synagogue of Satan is directly behind it all. They're liars, people. Not all Jews are part of this. You understand? It's very, very difficult, and you'll never figure it out and understand it if you're not in the Spirit of Christ, because it witnesses the truth. I don't hate the Jews. I hate the synagogue of Satan, because they are the seed of Satan. And they're out to destroy, kill, and steal men's souls. Just be aware that you're in this spiritual war. And you're not battling against men. These are spiritual powers and principalities. Wickedness in high places. It's a spirit that can only be fought through the Spirit of the living God by Jesus Christ. It's the only way to defeat this. So I pray you know him, and I pray you seek him if you don't. That's about all I got for you, so peace and grace to you.
To the Donald Trump Museum, dedicated to America's number one citizen and America's greatest living folk hero, the one and only Donald Trump. Learn the amazing history of the Trump family.
Somebody criticized me the other day because they asked me what I do, and I said, I'm going to bomb the shit out of them. It's true. I don't care.
Friends, and I guess I have some very good enemies, and I like it that way somehow, and I really believe in trashing your enemies.
Inside, you will learn how Donald Trump's father left him a large inheritance.
Nobody's going to do more women than Donald Trump. That I can tell you. That I can tell you. And I think they know it.
Discover how in 2016, Donald Trump successfully lobbied to legalize gambling.
Part of the beauty of me is that I'm very rich.
He wants to run for president and move on into the White House.
Why not?
Share in the stupidity of the average American as they made him the 45th president of the United States.
That will easily go down as the greatest president in the history of the United States. Me, no! Donald John Trump.
No!
Hey,
no!
Hey, wait, you come with us upstairs?
Let it go, Sonny. We can do this the easy way or the hard way.
The easy way.
We've all been missing, presumed dead for 5.5 years.
If you'd seen us that afternoon, we looked like a typical American family returning home from vacation. My brother Ben and his twins, Olive and Cal. But what you couldn't see is that Cal's leukemia wasn't responding to treatment.
This flight is oversold. We are offering travel vouchers for any...
That's me.
So Grace and Olive and my folks took the first flight home. Funny how one little decision can ruin your life, but also save it. Excuse me, what exactly is the problem?
The problem, ladies and gentlemen, is you've all been missing, presumed dead for 5.5 years.
You haven't aged a day.
Olive.
I'm sleeping. Where's mom?
Your mom got sick.
No, Dad. No, no.
Your cell regeneration model?
It works.
We've been treating pediatric patients for 30 months.
We pick up with the same regimen, right where we left off.
There's a new treatment protocol for pediatric cases. If we get a jump in the treatment, odds are excellent.
Didn't expect you getting back to work this fast.
A lot has changed since you've been gone.
Who is she?
It was 2 years before I even looked at another woman.
Even before I got on that plane, I lost sight of your life. We're gonna fix that. I'm not going anywhere.
The universe just gave all of us a do-over.
Everything checks out.
It's as if the plane never left the sky.
Do I have to say out loud that that's impossible?
I think we've taken impossible off the table.
Is your mind messing with you? Earlier today, I heard a voice in my head.
Keep it to yourself. What do you think? The government just forgot about us?
Just maybe he came back to be saved, and I came back to save him. How'd you know I was here?
I just knew.
What is this? There were a lot of people on that plane. What makes us so special?
What's the probability it's just you and me?
No one can explain what happened to us. Some people called it impossible. Others called it a miracle. All I know is whatever force brought us all here had no interest in being investigated. This was just the beginning.
FedEx 88, broadcasting in the fly. How do you read? Tahiti Control, FedEx 88, broadcasting in the fly.
6 hours, 42 minutes, 12 seconds.
Yards from impact.
Officially running for President of the United States.
And the American man here was incredibly false.
I am officially running.
And the American man here was incredibly false. Clear.
The Freemasons have the apotheosis of Washington and the Capitol building in Washington, D.C., of Washington becoming God, which is the same as Titus becoming God and the apotheosis. So man being God, they keep repeating this. What do they want to do these days with Kurzweil, transhumanism, and all these other things? They want to make man God. Michio Kaku saying that, what is it, nanobots can replace the synaptic material of the brain until you just have a schematic brain. And in a future show, we'll get really heavy duty into the brain chips of IBM and other things of the hive mind that we have been researching for so long. But this show is specifically just to show the in plain sight rebellion of modern man through the United Nations and all these global leaders, that they are doing the same thing that the Titus Arch resents. They are going to rebel, declare themselves God, and we have no need of a God because we are our own gods. That really came home for me when I looked at this event that I became aware of off of watching a Fox News presentation called the Invictus Games. Where do we get the name Invictus from, Chris?
From the sun god, Sol Invictus.
And when is that birthday, Sol Invictus, celebrated?
December 25th.
So here we got the sun worshippers, and everybody's heard for a long time that, we've been doing the worshippers of the moon versus the worshippers of the sun. We discussed CERN being over the temple of the sun with the Apollyon and Jerusalem and things with the temples of the moon. There's those who worship the sun, those who worship the moon, and a lot of this stuff goes back to sun worship. Invictus Games became very interesting to me because I wasn't really aware of it. I'm not making any allusions to being disrespectful in any which ways to wounded warriors, and that's not even the topic that I'm discussing. I'm discussing the symbolism that all the men and women who serve in the armed forces and are injured and putting their lives back together, we applaud them and support them in every way we can. I just found that this one was connected to the royal family through Prince Harry, and it's a very interesting game. It's basically just support wounded warriors and give them their own athletic events and build community and support around wounded soldiers coming back home and their value and all those things, which is fine. What did you think the first time that you looked at this show, Chris?
It really bothered me for a few things. I mean, we know that Prince Harry claims that he is an inheritor of the royalties, you know, of the royal family. And I do believe, in my opinion, that's the bloodline of Cain. But it really bothered me because it says, I am. Jesus is I am. He is the light of the world. Jesus is the great I am. And so when I keep seeing this, I'm the master of my fate. I'm the captain of my soul. It really bothered me because Jesus should be the captain of everybody's soul.